Let's talk about technology, because you've become the leader in terms of digitization. The iPhone obviously revolutionized so many industries. Tell us what your customer can do at B of A with all of the money you've put into technology and digitizing your business.
Well, if you think about it on the consumer side, which is easiest for people to think about, because all this goes on the institutional side. And so on the consumer side, they have a branch in their pocket. Anything you can do at a branch, you know, in a traditional banking sense or over the phone, you can do in your app. And there's 36 million digital users, or 26 million mobile users who are not digital users, they don't use a computer, growing at 10-15% a year. Sales are up at over the 20% level. 25% of all sales are digital. Our digital mortgage product is growing. Our digital auto product is growing. But what you can do is do everything. And then we have Erica. So we have 5 million Erica users. It only started about a year or so ago. And that's people can just talk and ask questions, and it learns about you. So artificial intelligence voice recognition program that will basically say, like, I was looking for a particular check, and I said, did I get a check back from a tax authority on a refund, or did I get a deposit back? Not even a check. Yes, you got this back from New York State Tax Authority or something like that. These are interesting things that change the nature. When you pay your bills, you just say, I need to pay X, and it says, you want to pay X? Yes, here's the amount. So think about how easy that is versus writing out checks or even going into bill payment. So the technology enables consumers to do more faster, easier. Half the checks we have are deposited at the ATM. A little over 25% are deposited by people taking pictures of them at the phone. Think about that. If you drive the ATM, put it in, if you take a picture, it's the exact same activity.
That's
but you don't have to go down. It's actually, think about it as environmentally more friendly if you don't drive the ATM, or time savings. And so you can do everything. Interesting enough, where the application on the institutional side is getting interesting too. So believe it or not, corporate treasurers want mobile capabilities to be able to do what we call cash pro mobile, initiate $5 million wire with a mobile device sitting in a meeting, with all the controls around it and all the foreign currency and all that stuff. To me, it was always, really? They're going to, and absolutely they want to do it, because that's the way they're used to operating.
Does that mean you had to ramp up in terms of investment in cyber and protecting all of this data?
Yeah, when I became CEO a decade ago, almost now, this is my 10th year, I guess.
Congratulations. But 10 years, wow.
That's a survival. But it was a great time, and I'm looking forward to doing it for a long time more. But if you think about it, I think we spent $200, maybe $300 million. We crossed over $700 this last year on it. And we Kathy Bessant and the team who work on that do a great job. A fellow named Craig Frelick is our CISO, so-called, and they do a great job. 3,000 people, more or less, and we just have to be safe. And by the way, as an industry, we work together with my colleagues across industry to make sure our industry is safe, and we've stayed ahead of the curve, knock on wood, we hope we can.
So fintech sort of nipping at your heels, do you even have to acquire a fintech company? Do you feel you have the scale, or...
We have a scale.
In terms of the digitization.
We had a billion and a half logins to our apps last quarter. So this is not theoretical.
A billion and a half.
So we are one of the larger digital companies. Right? We're also one of the larger physical companies. It takes both high touch and high tech. Now, what do we learn? We always are a curious company. We have to stay curious. We have to think about things. So we're always out there learning. So when we go to talk to fintech companies or observe what they're doing, more importantly, we're trying to learn, what does the customer see in that activity that they don't see in our activity? And then how do we adapt that? So a good example is about 4 years ago, because of the crisis and everything and the charge-offs we took in small business, we had lengthened our small business approval process to like 20 days. And if you think about 4 or 5 years ago, the advent of the mobile lenders and stuff like that in small business, and they were 20 minutes. Now, I'm not sure you can do it in 20 minutes. I'll leave that to the next recession to test, but 20 days was too long. So we brought that back in by using this mobile apps and things like that. That then ignited our small business, and we do more small business than most of the people in the world.
So what kind of a year would you expect when you look at small business, when you look at investment in terms of deals, M&A, and capital markets? What are you expecting?
Just talking to some of the team, the pipelines are decent in M&A, and you're seeing a lot of big deals, but also the activity is solid and strong there. I think when you think about small business, the interesting thing is the business community in the United States is very optimistic still, even though they're not as optimistic as they were at the highest point, which everybody points to. They're still very optimistic on a relative basis. And our small business surveys, late last fall and stuff, are we're going to invest more, we're going to hire more, we can't get people. Those are the common themes. And so I think it's a good year for investment. As long as we solve a couple of the key issues, we got to get the shutdown done, because it's more the incremental impact of the workers and stuff is important, but it's also just the process of getting approvals and stuff is being held up. We got to get that done. And then ultimately, a trade situation has to solve it. But I'm not giving you any news. Everybody says that, but it's time to get some of that stuff done.
What about the political environment? You've got people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez talking about 70% tax rates. The Democrats, if they take the Senate in 2 years, does that mean heavier regulation? You know what Elizabeth Warren wants to do with the banks?
Well, if you think about our company, when I get asked about this stuff, I said, we've been around for some tough elections. That one in 1800 that they made the play about, we were here then and we'll be here for the next one. So it ebbs and flows in 9 states. But at the end of the day, a company like ours that drives responsible growth, that delivers for our teammates, delivers for our shareholders, and delivers for the communities, we'll be fine.
All right, final question, Brian. I know you're up at the limit on deposits in the U.S., but as a global SIFI, can you acquire overseas? Would you even want to acquire consumer lending abroad?
We have... Outside the United States, we serve large companies and large investors. That's a business which is a global business. We also bring U.S. mid-sized companies to the world and things like that. We have not yet seen any, and not that we'd acquire anybody because it's not our strategy or organic growth totally, but the scalability of consumer businesses outside our country is at issue. And so we got out of the wealth management business outside the United States because we basically had $1.5 billion of revenue and didn't make a penny. And those resources could be better served to attack these markets in the United States. We still have massive opportunity.
How about a fintech acquisition?
Yeah, no acquisitions. We just work.